In this segment, we're going to talk about the Gauss-Seidel method of solving simultaneous linear equations. And we're going to talk about the theory in this part. Now, you might be already familiar with when you're solving simultaneous linear equations, if you write them in the matrix form. So if you have n simultaneous linear equations, then the matrix form will look like this, where C is your right-hand side, A is your coefficient matrix, and X is the solution vector or the unknown vector. And you're trying to find out what X is given what A and C are. You might also be familiar with already with methods like Gaussian elimination. Which are based on forward elimination and back substitution. And Gauss elimination is a direct method where you go through the steps of forward elimination and back substitution and you get the results. So the question arises that why do we need to learn another method to solve a set of simultaneous linear equations when Gauss elimination is pretty straightforward? It's a direct method. You do your steps of forward elimination, you do steps of back substitution, and you get your answer. Now, the reason why that is so is because of two main reasons. One, maybe computationally more efficient. For large n, because Gauss-Seidel method is an iterative procedure. It's not a direct method of solving a set of simultaneous linear equations. It's an iterative procedure where you're going to guess the solution, and then you're going to start making the solution better and better by following the algorithm for Gauss-Seidel method. So it might be computationally more efficient for a large n, because as n becomes very large, Gauss elimination does take a lot of computational time to solve. And the second one is that you can control round-off error, because in Gauss elimination, the only way you can control the round-off error is by either by choosing Gauss elimination partial pivoting, or by increasing the number of bits you use to store your numbers, going from single precision to double precision or to quad precision. But here, because it's an iterative procedure, you can control the round of error because you can stop the procedure as soon as the absolute relative approximate is less than some pre-specified tolerance. You don't have that luxury in Gauss elimination. So those are the reasons why we want to talk about Gauss-Seidel method. So let's go and see then what Gauss-Seidel method is all about. If you go back and look at the set of simultaneous linear equations which might be given to you in matrix form, where A is the coefficient matrix, X is the solution vector, and C is the right-hand side vector, what we want to be able to do is we want to be able to find out what X is. So what Gauss-Seidel method is all about is that if I write down the first equation in the regular form, in the expanded form, this is what I will get. I'll get A11X1 plus a sub 1, 2, x sub 2, plus all the way up to a sub 1, n, xn is equal to c sub 1. This will be the first equation which you're going to write. If you're going to go ahead and take this expanded form of this matrix form. And what you do in Gauss-Seidel method is that you basically take the first equation, so you're going to take the first unknown which you have there, and you're going to take everything to the right-hand side. So what that means is that you're going to take everything to the right-hand side. Like, you're going to take this to the right-hand side, the next term to the right-hand side, the last term to the right-hand side, and then divided by A11. So what you're doing is you're rewriting the first equation just in terms of X1. Now, some people might say, hey, you're taking things to the right-hand side which you don't know. But that's the whole point, that, yes, X1 is an unknown, so is X2, X3, all the way up to Xn. And we are taking to the right-hand side. Generally, we only take the known things to the right-hand side. But the reason why we are doing that is because we are just writing the whole equation just in terms of x1. And since we are going to be assuming the values, the initial values of x1, x2, all the way up to xn, it gives us a way of being able to figure out a better value of x1. So same thing is going to happen if you had the ith equation, let's suppose. So let's write the equation for the ith equation. So I can be anywhere from 1 less than equal to I less than equal to n, where n is the number of equations which you have. So the ith equation is going to look like this. It's going to look like ith row, first column, x1, plus all the way up to the ith row, ith column, x of I, plus all the way up to a sub I n is equal to x of I, is equal to c sub I. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to write down the general equation for any equation which you will get out of these n equations. So writing the ith equation where I can be anywhere from 1 to n. So we're going to do the same thing because we are writing the equation, the ith equation. We're going to take the ith unknown and write it out by choosing, taking everything to the right-hand side except for this part here. So this will be x of n here. What I'll get is c sub I minus ai1 x1 minus all the way up to minus ain x of n divided by a sub ii. That's what I'm going to get. So this is the ith equation, and I can be anywhere from 1 to n, so I can write I is equal to 1 all the way up to n. So if I want to write in a compact form so that I can algorithmically write a program for it or discuss it in a flow chart, I'll write like this, summation a sub ij xj, j going from 1 to n, divided by a sub ii. So all I'm doing is I'm bundling all these terms which I write have here. I'm going to bundle them there by saying a sub I1 x1, a sub I2 x2. Those are all the terms which will be taken care of by this. The only term which is not there is this a sub ii times x sub I. You don't see a sub ii x sub I here because it's right here. So I'll have to say j not equal to I in the summation. So now you can very well see that how one would be able to take this particular formula and program it in such a fashion that you are able to get the values of x of I having started with some new, some old values. So the way the algorithm works is that you're going to start with some initial value of all the x's, and you're going to find the new value of x's by using this particular formula here for the ith equation. And one of the things which you do is that you keep on updating the recent value of x of I. So for example, if you have written the formula for x1, you don't use in x2, you're going to use the new value of x1 which you obtained. So the x vector which you are using for the process keeps on gets updated regularly as opposed to at the end of the iteration. So I'm going to write down the algorithm, and that will make it a little bit clearer. But the main thing is to understand how we have rewritten each of the equations which we have.